So we begin with my friend David Snow.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let's say that one more time. Good afternoon, everyone. There you go. At least I have your attention for 30 seconds. What I want to talk about today, I kind of call pathways to the street the focus of our discussion on kind of causes, underlying causes of homelessness. My fellow researcher, Dr. Rachel Goldberg of Elwood, was not able to join us today, so I'll have to answer all the questions, and if there's some I cannot answer, I can always refer them to her. Okay, I think one good way to think about homelessness and its causes is to think about the game of musical chairs. And in thinking about musical chairs, there's two questions. If you think of the chairs as kind of the houses and the people left standing, the homeless. What set of factors caused the chairs or the housing to be removed or to be in short supply? And what factors or causes some people, the homeless, to be left standing rather than others? And I say in an evidence-based world because it's not always clear today that some people think we live in an evidence-based world, but coming from a university, of course, that's very important to evidence. So the answer to these two questions resides in the interaction, the intersection between these two sets of factors, structural factors or antecedents of the limited or inaccessible housing. That is the metaphoric chairs in the game of musical chairs, and the personal biographic deficits which accentuate vulnerability of some people rather than other people being left standing, the homeless. And I emphasize this because we often think in terms of one factor, it's housing, or it's this, or it's that, it's drugs, it's alcohol, but really it's the intersection, the interaction of these factors. So what I want to do is turn to some of the data from the cost study in which we interviewed, among other things, over 250 homeless. Many of you have seen the cost study. I brought a few copies of it. If you haven't seen it, you can check with me at the end. Now, one of the things we did, the many questions we asked in the interviews, is your most recent experience, what kind of factors caused you to become homeless? And these are the factors mentioned. You recognize all the difficulty of securing or retaining jobs with sustainable wages. That was 40%. Retaining affordable housing, 36%. Then there were a number of factors that congeal under what we call family issues. Abuse, sexual violence, of course, one type of abuse, death, family instability, 28%, drugs and alcohol, 22%, and so on down to recent release from prison and jail, 7%. But again, the problem is these are not, each of them, independent factors. It's not like somebody just ends up on the street because of drugs, or early release from prison, or can't find any housing. It's because of the interaction of a number of these factors. So, just breaking that up, going back to the factors that account for the elimination of the chairs, of the housing, the structural antecedents here, and then the biographic deficits and vulnerabilities. So then the question becomes, how do these intersect? How do they interact? What are the different probabilities that predict some people with some combinations of these will end up homeless and not others? So what we've done here, and I'm not going to go into the detail, but this is the kind of statistical analysis that looks at different clusters of factors. And what we've done is separate them, the women from the men. And here I hope you can see that there are, you can see by the pie graph, there's the different colors, three clusters. The large one for women is the lack of affordable housing and job loss, 74%. Then you have cluster two, primary factor is domestic violence, and cluster three, drugs and alcohol. But that doesn't mean the other factors don't intersect with these. So when we look over here, and this is of course going to be hard for you to see, but what each of these bars, blue bars here, indicates for mental health, physical health, release from jail and prison, the probability of those clustered in number one, the probability that one of these other issues will be present. And so you see the big cluster in here, the bars, about 50% for lack of affordable housing, insufficient wages, job loss. All these other factors are 15% or less. So there's a 15% probability that a woman with mental health problems will be in this cluster. 15% probability with physical health, about a 7% probability of early release from jail and prison, death of the family, and so on. So it goes back to my point that these things interact. And they're different clusters of factors, but here, again, for homeless women, the big factor is these structural antecedents. The lack of affordable housing and job loss, which are insufficient wages, which means whatever housing available, you can't access it because the wages are not adequate. If we go over here to the second cluster, domestic violence, in this cluster, 100% of the women are victims of domestic violence. So that's a fifth of all the women in this category, of all the women in the sample who have experienced domestic violence as a primary cause. And then there are other factors, but not as pronounced, like mental health and physical health and other family issues. And then the last one, 5%, drugs and alcohol. And you can see here for drugs and alcohol, it's 100% drugs, quite a few alcohol, and some early release from jail or prison. So you see how some of these factors cluster together. So oftentimes we end up saying, well, it's all drugs and alcohol, or it's all mental health, or this or that, and that's the wrong answer, at least according to our analysis. It's how some of these things intersect and interact. And if you have some questions about these probabilities, I can take those later. When we go to men, the clusters are a little different. The cluster one is lack of affordable housing and job loss, not quite as large as with respect to women. But the probabilities, again, you see some mental health, physical health problems, death in the family, alcohol and drugs, those are beneath 10% in this, but the big drivers, again, lack of affordable housing, job loss, insufficient wages. The second cluster for men, 22%, family issues, drugs and health. And you can see there in the bar graph, the orange, the family issues is the largest category. Then you have followed by drugs and then health problems. An example of this is one fellow who we interviewed who had been on the streets for 17 years in Orange County. Interviewed him at the Newport Beach Transit Center. And the reason he had a few health issues initially and a couple other issues, but what really kicked him onto the streets were family issues. His mother had died, was living with his stepfather, but his stepfather never cared for him, so as soon as the mother died, he brought in a girlfriend and kicked out this fellow, and he was not fully capable of taking care of himself. And whatever problems, health problems he had prior to being kicked out of the household and onto the streets, of course, escalated the longer he was on the street, and he became a severely disabled, chronic homeless person, that is, on the street for longer than a year, and in his case, multiple disabilities, including heart disease, emphysema, of course, high blood pressure, phlebitis, and so on. Decline in real earnings or jobs, that's still an ongoing problem. And changes in the labor market. The labor market is essentially two clustered, a primary labor market for most of the folks in here who are educated, college degrees. Secondary labor market is always lower wages. And it's not only that, the secondary labor market changed dramatically, since the late 1970s, from a manufacturing sector to a service sector. And service sector income salaries are much lower than they were in the manufacturing sector. One reason is because of the decline of unions associated with steel industry, automobile industry, and so on. But some of those factors are still operative. In terms of affecting housing availability, you will hear from two of our speakers about those factors in just a moment. But as many of you know, living in Orange County, the cost of housing is among the highest in the country, and so is the cost of rent. But again, that doesn't necessarily determine which individuals will become homeless. And there we turn to biographical deficits again. And these are different factors. Individuals with what economists call human capital, limited human capital. That is lower education. And job experience, it's limited job experience or job records, again, in the secondary labor market, which doesn't necessarily put you in a top spot for jobs which require more education or experience. Limited social capital. Social capital is a term that social scientists use to refer to the kind of different sets of connections people have to each other. Family background, family social capital. I just mentioned an example of the one fellow whose family social capital was limited with respect to him anyway, related to the extent of family support and friendship networks. For many homeless, the tightest friendship networks they have, of course, are those folks on the streets. And having friends on the street works in two ways. If you have friends on the streets, it facilitates survival on the streets, but it can also act as an impediment to getting off the street because you want to be with those who support you and your friends. And then personal disabilities, substance abuse, addiction, mental illness, physical disabilities, all of these factors individually or in interaction increase one vulnerability and probability of ending up on the street, given the structural antecedents. So, to wrap this up here, kind of, homelessness, one way to think about it, exists in a gap between the availability and affordability of housing and the income available to access that housing. But, and I underscore but, the odds of falling into that gap increases with one or more biographical deficits. So you can see how it's a highly interactive kind of process. So to wrap up what I want to say here, four factors to keep in mind. It's probably best to think of homelessness as a social situation in which some people find themselves, rather than a characteristic of the person so situated. It is a social condition rather than a social type. Second, homeless people are people for whom there are no available or accessible housing slots because of the intersection of some combination of structural factors that I mentioned and personal biographic deficits or vulnerabilities. Third, and this may be a little more complicated, if so, then homelessness is most generally the result of a failure or breakdown of societal abeyance processes and systems. What do I mean by abeyance processes? Probably none of you remember very well, but you know about the WPA, Franklin Roosevelt's Works Progress Administration, in which he had all these kind of construction projects that the government helped funded, but it was a way to deal with depression and getting people back to work. So it was a way of serving people that were kind of out of place and didn't have something to do. With respect to homelessness, throughout time there are different kinds of abeyance structures. We used to have in the large cities, usually close to skid row areas, or if there were skid rows, what was called SRO, single room only. Single room only housing was gentrification across major cities. Was eliminated, a big elimination process beginning in the 70s and through the 80s. That's a kind of abeyance structure. Shelters, transitional housing, rapid rehousing, permanent supportive housing are all part of this abeyance system. So it's a failure in the abeyance process that these processes exist to modulate, to deal with the mismatch between available positions or beds too few in different arenas when there's a supply of claimants for those positions or slots too many. And it's this disjunction, and that's one of the things we have to come to grips with and deal with. And again, two of our speakers, well, I'm sure can address that better than I can. So finally, homelessness will continue to persist until there's a functioning abeyance system for absorbing and accommodating surplus or out-of-place populations. One final thing I want to add here is I didn't say too much about health, and Karen McClellan would talk about health among other things. The problem, according to our analysis, the cost, it's intersection of absence in housing and escalating health problems. But it's not necessarily health problems that drive most people to the streets. And so once they hit the street, their health problems escalate, multiply. And that's where the cost. I think one of our findings was the average cost in Orange County of keeping someone on the street 3 years was right around $45,000. If the chronically homeless, so those with health problems, were housed in permanent supportive housing, the average cost would drop to $10,000 a year. I mean, that's a tremendous difference. So Karen can address some of these issues. But again, I want to leave you with these observations and the importance of thinking, not just in terms of health or just housing absence, but the intersection of these factors, and that homelessness, again, is a social situation. It's not a social type. Thank you.
Thank you, David. One clarifying question. Does anybody have a question that, Jerry?
Yeah. How many of the homeless in your count were employed at the time you talked to them?
Could you repeat the question before you?
He asked how many were employed in our study. And I can actually turn to that report to find it, but I can't tell you off the top of my head. There are just too many figures in there. And sometimes it's better to try than to sit around and memorize it. And then really get confused. But I'll look that up, and we can bring it up later.
That would be great. Thank you, David.